behind.
While we get the computers organized, I'd like to present the last talk for today, which is Professor Norbert, and I'm sorry I could not pronounce his surname, so I got permission to say this Professor Norbert, and he'll tell us his surname. He was the Assistant Dean for International Cooperation at the University of Maribor in Slovenia. He's a full professor of educational psychology and neuropsychology. He's the Slovenian National Correspondent for Early and a member of the Slovenian National Board of UNESCO, a member of editorial board of many journals. He's written numerous papers, chapters, and books, and editorials on psychology and neuroscience. His main area of research is human intelligence and giftedness, as well as other topics in cognitive and educational psychology. And the talk today will be giving us is entitled, Can We Increase Intelligence? Well, I'm sure we've increased our intelligence tremendously today from all our talks, and we can see if we can do any more.
This is an action potential, and this is equal for everything. So
is equally for this vision of digital, tactile, and everything. But we distinguish things, and we actually, what is the problem? How does it go that we can combine this together in a section? Or in a total thing, Gestalt could be said. So, for instance, yesterday, when we were listening to the piano, all of us who are no piano players were listening with the Heschel ears. This is here in this side, primary auditory area. But all of you who play a piano were listening with the motoric cortex too. So you were listening with your fingers. This is, I don't know, are there any piano players here? Okay. So this is the thing which is very interesting about the brain. So on the external morphology, best brain is best represented if you make a fist with your right hand and then you just look at it. So this would be the distinction. And if you cut here through, then you would have a coronal cut and with a frontal view, and this is the frontal view of the brain. And then you have here some clefts, which are sometimes called sulcus and sometimes called histories, depends on how big they are. And then you have some bumps, which are called gyri, and then you have the gray matter, and you have the white matter, and there is some reticular formation, which is so not gray and not white altogether. So the new idea in neuroscience now is that actually, if we look at the brain as something that connects, and the connection is so important, then actually we would like to know how is this done. And in 2010, I think, they started this program of the human conic cone, and then the new articles which are appearing try to explain behavior through this connection viewpoint. So now we have three maybe main connections. This is a default mode of network. This means this is what we encounter during resting. Actually, this is now done by fMRI or MRI, and so the people are somehow inventing something what in EEG was known for a long period, that resting EEG has some connections with different behaviors. So you could do some correlation studies. So the second network is the celiac network, which activates where, for instance, inside here a lion would appear, or maybe a terrorist, it would be more possible than a lion, and then everybody would be somehow alert. That would also involve sensory and limbic inputs. So this would be the thing. And the last thing here is, of course, the dorsal lateral parietal connection, which is activated in problem solving. So this is the last idea which is now investigated for rather, let's say, 5 years and bring some results. So let's go to the intelligence construct. So the Carroll's three strata theory, you probably know, all of you know the theory. It's a theory where you have one G, then you have some specific factors like fluid intelligence, which is mostly studied in this correlation studies, and then you have a lot of narrow abilities. There are, of course, other theories. One very interesting or popular was Gardner's theory, or his Gardner theory, and the other one is Sternberg's triarchic theory. I like this theory because of the definition, because it states actually that intelligence means that you find something that you like to do, and then in the next step, somebody who gives you the money for that. And in the scientific way, it reads like that. So it's not so. But this is actually the main thing. And it actually has three levels. I won't go into details, because neuroscience has ignored both these theories. So neuroscience, the relationship is done on the Carroll's three-strata theory, and I will show you now some results which give you some information of this relationship. So I will be talking about microscopic cellular structure and macroscopic in relation to G, and of course this element, and then also some functional difference. So let's have a look at the microscopic level. So this was an article in Intelligence in 2014 about Einstein's brain. So Einstein, when he died, I think he was in 55, his vision was to be cremated. But the pathologist, Harvey, had the idea to preserve the brain. And the son then kept this brain some 30 years. And then in 1999 or something like that, two articles appeared which actually worked on the cellular structure. And the first one was that he had more VIA cells in the left parietal cortex, the normal brain, and the second thing was the higher density of neurons in the right prefrontal cortex. This was done on a very low amount of slices, so it's not a representative study, but it's interesting because actually dyslexia is related to the first finding and schizophrenia to the second one. And the conclusion out of this is that there is, at the moment, based on this number of elements, we have no final answer. So if we go now to the volume, I like this part, the greatest is this part, because you see the correlation is very high with the volume, brain volume and IQ, and this is higher for the gray matter than for the white matter. And what I like in the audience of a lot of ladies to say the main brain is 100 grams heavier. And according to Niebuhr, this would make out 3 IQ points. But this can be discussed later on. And this is a wake up now for all of you. The next thing is that cortical thickness is also positively correlated. But of course, what is interesting is not that actually there is a developmental aspect in it. So if you look, this cortical thickness when you were, let's say, 5 years or 4 years old is negatively correlated, but if you are adult, then it becomes positively correlated. And this study is very interesting because if you look here, the author compared three groups, superior, with this matters high and average. And the increase in thickness for the superior group is at about 11 years, for the above average 9, and for the average ones, they have the thickness developed at 7 years. So there is a difference in this. Cortical convolution has a similar distribution of more convolution in the occipital temporal area here, left hemisphere, is positively correlated. So this is the morphological studies, and then now let's go to functional studies. I would say, oh yes, the loss of thickness also, this is the corpus callosum which combines both hemispheres, this is also positively correlated. Now let's go to the IQ, the functional studies. So we have a lot of findings, and the main finding maybe is that we have the neural efficiency theory which states that the more intelligent you are, the less activity in the brain is shown up. So the more your intelligence is, the less active your brain is. But these findings are only confirmed when you take some moderating variables. So the first thing is this inverse regulation is related when there is some differences in sex. So usually this is shown for women, this relationship is shown when they do verbal tasks, but this verbal fluency tasks. This is normal because even I think in the Torah there's written when God gave speech to men, he gave 9 chairs to women and 1 chair to us. So this is expected. And the same thing we did the study is for emotional intelligence. So women also showed this relation on emotional intelligence task, and men showed it on, let's say, this paper cutting tasks, and also this task is where you have this rotational problem. So when you have to rotate mentally two-dimensional picture as a three-dimensional. This is the thing. The next thing is that this interaction is related to complexity of the task. So it works only with moderate difficulty. Not with, when the tasks are very difficult, then you get a totally different picture. And this is what was found out by Doppelmayr, I think, some 4 years ago. And also in a recent intelligence study by a group from Austria, Graubner, they replicated the same result. So it works only, this is only for very, very, let's say, not simple tasks, but for medium difficulty and complexity. And the last thing, which is mainly efficiency shown in the frontal areas, but not in the parietal areas. So in the parietal areas, you would have more activity, and only in the frontal areas, you would have this difference. So another theory I must mention is the Pareto theory or Pareto frontal integration theory by Heyer, based on MRI studies. And what is actually, this is a debate going on: is intelligence mainly frontal, or is it also related to other parts? And his idea is that it's related to the parietal, occipital, and other areas. Whereas Duncan, the professor from Oxford or Cambridge, has the idea that it's mainly frontal. And here is now the explanation of this theory, but the problem is that it doesn't work uniquely. So if you have a test, let's say, in the United States, and you do the same test, a different test in Spain, then you get different areas which are activated, which is somehow annoying for the explanation. So this, I would say, neural efficiency at the moment is the best thing to be what we have in relation brain IQ. The next thing now is, can, this is the main question we have, can intelligence be trained? Now I would like to thank Julia, yeah, because you have this little wife, isn't it? Yeah. for her genetic explanation, I would maybe just add one thing, that some studies have shown that actually this genetic relationship is more pronounced, so it's about 60%, when you are coming from a family which is wealthy, and it's the opposite, the 60% explained variance is when you're coming, it's environment when you're coming from a poor family. So the idea is, or the interpretation was, that the socioeconomic status, actually, if you have more money, you trigger with the environment, with what you give the child, more than if you have no money. So this is the explanation, but okay, I will go into genetics, your domain. And another thing which is also important is that the new studies in neuroscience have shown that the brain has a great plasticity and is actually able to be modified by very simple tasks. So juggling tasks, piano playing, just maybe 4 hours, you can have increases in brain volume in these areas. And so this is something what gives some support to the possibility to increase intelligence. So what training can be used? Behavior training is the most obvious. So the second one is neurofeedback. I think you know what actually it means. So you are trained in some to do based on a computer screen, and on the EEG you have, you are trained to do, let's say, reduced theta in the frontal area or whatsoever. And then you do that, and then this can be used then to influence your performance. The next thing is nutrition. So it's very important what you what you eat, but it's not that you eat a banana or something like that, it's more complicated. And the last thing is different brain stimulation, so transcranial magnetic, and the new thing is different electrical stimulation to which I use. I will now just go to the two things here, show this result, and here the results are rather positive. So neurofeedback was shown to increase intelligence, but in mentally retarded children, and the training included, I think, something like 400 sessions of 20 to 30 minutes. So we did some research in our lab, but the students didn't like to come 400 times to give this gamble that happened. So, and we then didn't have any good results, so we then didn't do it anymore. But you can see here, there are different possibilities. And the next thing is nutrition. This is now the drug you should combine, and if you read this article, there are the exact amounts what you need to put in to increase 2 points on the rating progressive metrics test. But also there are other things. So the pine extract of the bark of the pine tree is also good. Then Indian thing, and also ginkgo, and also ginseng. So these are the studies which have shown increases in the latest, let's say, fashionable thing is chewing gum. So there are some studies who report chewing gum showed enhancement of memory performance. I took these mathematical skills because of the here. There have been done 3 studies. Two showed no increase. 1 study showed increase. So if you chew gum, can increase, and of course intelligence. This is a thing, and it also depends that more you chew, more hard you chew, the greater is the activity in your brain if you are an fMRI. So these are the studies which have been done till now related to intelligence. Nutrition. So next we are going to the behavior. Sorry, yes. Intelligence, I have been showing this slide before. You have tests for intelligence, and then these tests are, let's say, fluid intelligence would be the most popular test, would be rating methods. I will show you an example when we go to this, so you can see how the test looks like. Now, if we go to the behavior training, so this was somehow triggered by a study of working memory and working memory training by Yegi in 2008. So they did this study, and then they showed that their tasks, which were NDAC tasks, can increase intelligence in a group. And let's have a look now at this NDAC task. Just be a little sad and hope the stone will be going on.
As.
So you see, it was S and this position of the blue cube. This should be simultaneously. Here it's not. It's something not totally in the lab this works. And then the next one, this goes then off, and the next one is
Q.
And you see this. So it was S, Q, and this position was the same. So if the position is the same, you press one button, and if the tone is the same, you press another button. And then the next thing is again Q, we would press now equal for tone, and nothing for position. And now the tasks, this is very simple, but the tasks, what they were trained, they go this N, which means how much back you go, they went up to 5 things back. So you have to press this 5 things, what happened 5 things before. 1, 2, 3, etc. This is very complicated, and they were training and they found some results. So I'm just showing you what they did, and then I'm going to study with it. We use 3 different things. Here we have this matrix, and here if you look, this one is left down, and also if you find another one, this is here. Is it so? Yeah. And then we shoot this for, let's say, 20 seconds, 30 seconds, it depends on the difficulty. And then in the next step, this is a very difficult task. We shoot this left down, and the respondent had to answer A3. So he had to recall from memory where is the other pair of this arrow. And this was rather complex now. So the next one was like that. So you had a sequence, let's say here, euro, dollar, pound, and yen sign. And this was presented, let's say, two seconds less, 1 second each. And then after the last one, there was a 6 second or 7 second break with nothing, and then forward appeared. Okay? And then you had, and then euro appeared. And then you had to say if it's forward and if it's euro, it's one, because it was the first one. If it's backward, it's euro, it is forward, because it's four back. So this was another training, and the last one was the training we used for the same, similar to the EAP training. So what we found out, okay, this was a question about the test, pre-post test. This is the rating task. So you have, you can do that now, you have here a metric, and this is missing, and then you have to choose which one is the correct answer to put in here. So you can do that, but I think it's a rather difficult task, so I will show you the next one. This is a paper cutting task. So you have here an A4 paper sheet which is folded like that down, then again folded here, again folded down, and cut out here. Okay? And this is then the end product. And then the question is, when you unfold it again, how does it look like? Which one is the correct answer? You have, for here, this one, you have 10 seconds time, and for this one, you will have about 7 seconds. And you then have to press a button 1 to 4. The last task, this is also something for the ladies. This is the verbal analogy task, so fish, water, bird, and this is it. Now, has anybody the answer for the first one? Okay. These are the answers. Do you see that? Yes. One, this one, and this one. So they are all ones, so it's not so difficult. The next one is now we did then the analysis. Any question?
Why is one?
You mean here? Okay, here it is because if you look at this, if the white ones are on the same side and the black ones are also on the same side, then this is addition. If they are on the opposite side, then this is subtraction. And so you just turn them around and you get this, and if you turn this again around, you get this. You see? You put this so around, then you have just one this here and this two up there. So this is the IQ test, but then very the start is very easy and then it goes up to very difficult. So this is a medium difficulty level. Okay? No, you don't count them. Nothing to do with counting. I mean, this test try to be like that, that you have no influence of, let's say, education. So this is the main idea in fluid intelligence. So this is the thing. So you don't count, you just must have the idea why, and this is then turned around, this is, you see, addition, then you have subtraction, when it is, you turn it around, and the black one goes down there, the white one is there, it goes away, so you have just two blacks and one here. And here is the same, you turn it around, you have two whites, and just then, or if you look at on the horizontal or on the vertical side, here, you see it here down, if you do this, then you turn it around, and you have this and this and that. Okay, I mean, I could explain this, but
we have priming of counting, so I can't.
Okay. So Raven is rather, I would say, a test which is rather, let's say, used very widely in the world and rather objective, etc., etc. So I mean, you must complain to his son because he's the owner of the test. Now, the next thing is what we found out about results. So this is the we had a good design. We had a design with let's say control group and active control group and experimental group. The active control group was doing actually some other things, and they were all paired based on the EQ. But we used for the pairing, we used the Wechsler test for adults. So it's a different test. So we use the same. So they were paired together. So this is the these are then the results. You can see this is a memory span test. This is the rating test. This is the paper folding and cutting, and this is the analysis. And these are the increase. This is the sign. So only here there was no increase. But the others showed rather stable increase. So okay, this was then done, and we then also measured EEG when they were doing the test. And this is the brain. How it was working. Just be careful. Here, blue means this is theta. Here, blue means more activity. And for all this, it means this is alpha. Red means more activity. This is because it's inversely and directly related. And what you can see here, you can see that there was a faster and intensified working memory processing. This attentional part showed an inhibition in the occipital area, and this probably influenced this working memory increase. And in the alpha, we had an intensified abstract reasoning increase in activity. So these tasks were very difficult, so this is what we would actually expect, an increase in activity. We did also some near-infrared measures, which also showed an impact on this. This near-infrared is a device which is based on blood saturation. It's oxygen, similar to MRI, but not so precise. You put some light, near-infrared light, through your brain, catch out what comes out, and then you see how much is absorbed, and then you can say what activity was somewhere. So this was one study, but of course there are many studies who don't show this effect, and some studies who show it. I would say the general idea about everything is that the studies which show effect are related to motivation to some extent, and also to implicit theories you have about intelligence. So if your theory is that you can do something about intelligence, then there is some great effect, as if you think that there is nothing that can be done. So this is so the next is what we did is studies with brain stimulation. So I will show you just this different thing. This is transcranial direct stimulation, so you have direct currency applied to the brain, and it is thought that another, you don't see another. Anode increases activity, cathode increases, and then you have random noise, so you just put a frequency through and rising, let's say from 0,1 to 100, or from 100 to 640, and then you have this transcranial alternating stimulation, which we use actually because this is so appealing, and then you have another different things which are more technical. So maybe just the transcranial alternating stimulation. Here you can see you put this electrical electrodes on the brain, and then it is thought that this electrodes will, through entrainment, you see this is then done, entrain what is underneath and make it, it will perform in a specific frequency. Also the idea is that another aspect is resonance, so that you actually increase what is there to some extent. Okay, we did a study, we did a lot of studies, but we just showed you this based on intelligence. So this was the design. We had two groups. One was frontal stimulation, one was parietal, and this is the other group which remained the same. This was 15 minutes of stimulation, 5 minutes recording EEG, and then they did the problem solving, and then they had the questionnaire, and this is how it worked, the earth and earth And the result, and the frequency was theta, of course, because we were interested in theta mainly because it's a thought from theory. The theta is a gating frequency where you actually, the theta gamma coupling gives you, let's say, estimate of your working memory capacity. Yeah. And there was a parallel study in grants with fMRI, and here are the results of our study. So you can see increase in Raven tests on the general, the total score, and in Raven difficult tasks, not in the easy ones when you did variety. It was just the difficult which made the main conclusion, and the same pattern appeared for the performance, for paper coding and cutting tasks. On the frontal group, we had just this one thing for the easy task. And the Bama et al. Study, which was presented this year in Singapore on the conference on brain stimulation, the first conference which was there, which was organized, and the results are always the same. They use just the rating task, and this is the thing that the difficult tasks showed an increase. And then, if you look at the brain structure, you see almost identical. Charm means where there was no stimulation, where there was the placebo thinking barrier means where there was the stimulation, and you have this increase with a similar what you shown before in the alpha. They, and here you have the fMRI, which shows also a similar pattern. So I think this is all that happened. Now, if you have any questions, and if you don't have questions, let's go to dinner at the mine.
Thank you.
Where and then to see them, then they disappear, and then there's 1 second dead, and then you see them again, and then you say the color of one insert is the same as before. So there is no possibility of chunking, like for instance, when you have this classical memory span test, you can do something. This is a good result, and now we are doing a large scale study on work with memory. Not me, but that's it. Yes. After one session, yes. People don't like it, but I mean, students don't like it. But you have you can see for scan, though, and you have a trigger. It disappears, but some are more sensitive, and then they don't like it. So we do it at the beginning, and then just what they can bear. But the machine doesn't destroy your brain. Okay. Better in green, and so yes.
So.
No, about the electrical stimulation, not the magnetic. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. And I hope to see you all tomorrow morning. Thank you.
Thank you.